What I want to do in this video is think a little bit about the estate tax. Estate tax, and as the name of the tax implies, it is a tax on someone's estate, or when someone passes away, it is a tax on what they want to leave behind to whoever they want to leave it to, either in their will or in their family or whoever they want to leave their stuff to. And sometimes it's referred to as an inheritance tax. Inheritance tax. And sometimes you'll hear it talk this way on the news. Maybe it's a little bit derisive. It's called a death tax. A death tax. And the general idea, let's say that right now my entire net worth, I am worth $3 million. I am worth $3 million. And then I pass away. So this $3 million goes into my estate. So this is my estate. And so this $3 million could be all of my savings, could be my stock portfolio, could be the value of my land, my real estate, everything I own, my car. Everything combined is worth $3 million. It goes into my estate after I pass. And let's say I leave everything in my estate to my daughter. So I leave it to my daughter. It's at this point that the estate tax comes into question of how much money will my daughter get. It turns out for $3 million, my daughter is exempt. Inheritance from an individual, the first $5 million are exempt. So in this situation where I'm leaving $3 million for my daughter, she actually will get the entire $3 million. If let's say I'm even richer than that. Let's say that I have $6 million. So let's say the scenario where I have $6 million, it all goes to my estate. It all goes into the estate after my death. And now the first $5 million is exempt. So let me write my daughter over here. So my daughter will get the first $5 million tax-free. So $5 million tax-free. And then the increment above that exemption, the increment above what has been excluded, will then be taxed at a certain rate. And that rate is constantly changing. But for the sake of simplicity, I'm going to go with 35%. And that's actually the rate in 2011. So the rest of the $1 million taxed at 35%. So the federal government will tax 35% of the $1 million, so they will essentially take $350,000 for themselves. $350,000 for themselves, and my daughter will be left with $5,650,000, right? Because of this million, you take out $350,000, you have $650,000 left. So my daughter in this situation will be left with $5.65 million. So the federal government took $350,000. If I am super rich, let's say that I am worth, let me make a number to make the math easy so I don't have to get a calculator out. Let's say that I am worth $1,005,000,000. So this is my net worth. In this situation, the first $5 million will be excluded. So my daughter will get the $5 million. We'll get the $5 million directly. That will be excluded. And then everything above that will be taxed at the 35%. So in this situation, you have $1 billion taxed at 35%. So $1 billion at 35%. So in this scenario, the federal government will take $350 million. Would take $350 million, and so that would leave of this billion, $650 million left for my daughter. So in total, she would get this $650 million plus the $5 million that was excluded. She would end up with a total of $655 million. So I wouldn't feel too bad for her. She should be pretty OK. So that's just how the estate tax works. And these examples I gave with the $5 million that is excluded, this is for an individual when they pass away. If it's being done as a couple, this exemption is actually $10 million. So if between my wife and I, we have $1,005,000,000. And let's say I pass away and we own everything collectively, she actually gets the extra joint exemption passed on to her. And then if and when she passes away, this would be $10 million that will be tax-free. So in this scenario, if this is being done as a couple, my daughter would get the entire $6 million. Now, the interesting thing about the estate tax is it's highly contested. People always debate, is it wrong or is it right? And I'll touch on that a little bit. I don't want to, you know, I'll let you decide for yourself. But I'll give what I, at least in what I hear, is the main arguments for or against the estate tax. So like most taxes, there's always someone who will believe that it is unfair. So let me write the for and the against. For and against. For and against the estate tax. So some people say it's unfair. Look, over the course of my life, I earned all of this money. I paid all of these income taxes off of the money I earned. And now the stuff that I want to leave behind to my children, I am not able to leave it all to them, because obviously $655 million is not enough. They deserve the entire $1.5 billion for being my child. And so there's this argument that it is unfair, or it's some kind of double taxation. The money was taxed the first time it was earned, and now it's being taxed again once it's being inherited. The counter argument to that is double taxation is everywhere in our society. Corporations pay taxes, and then they give dividends, and the owners and the stockholders pay taxes again. And that's kind of an exchange for having the limited liability of the corporation. You pay taxes on your income, and then with that after-tax income, you go buy something at the store. Once again, you pay sales tax. So double taxation, it happens everywhere. The for argument, and somewhat the counter argument against the unfairness of it all, is that, look, we're exempting, depending on how you view it, the first $5 or $10 million. So 5 to 10 million is exempt. Exempt. So it's a little bit, the person who's for the estate tax would say, look, it's a little disingenuous when you make this impression that your children are going to suffer because they're not going to be able to get your house, or they're not going to be able to get your car. They're going to be able to get all of that as long as it's worth less than $10 million, which is not a small amount of money. And even above that, they're going to get 65% of everything. So it's not like your children are going to be left hungry because of the estate tax. And it's actually a very small number of people that the estate tax will even hit. Really, the rich, because even the upper middle class, very few of them will leave more than $10 million behind. The other argument is, if you're going to tax anything, so what to tax? What to tax? Do you tax income? And obviously, you do have to tax income to some degree to get enough revenue for the federal government. But isn't it better to tax someone who did not work for the money? Someone who is getting the money, I mean, maybe they already got every other privilege in life. They went to the best schools and all the rest, and through connections, maybe good jobs. Why not tax the person who is already lucky to some degree by virtue of, and this is just the argument someone would make. And by the way, they're still going to get a lot of that money. It's not like they're going to be left poor. They're still going to be fine. And to some degree, maybe if they have a little bit less, it will be more of an incentive for them to work. The other argument for the estate tax, and this is kind of a broader, almost a macro view of things, of what might be good for society, is if you don't have an estate tax, and we know that there's these huge fortunes in the world where someone creates a big business empire, and they have billions upon billions of dollars. And if someone has $10 billion, and let's say they don't have that many children that they leave it behind to. Maybe they only have one child, and they leave that $10 billion to that one child. Then that one child can literally just let that income passively earn interest. They'll never have to work the rest of their life. And through the passive earnings of just the assets being invested, that over the course of that child's life might grow to $30 billion. It'll definitely grow faster than the economy itself. And then that child, if they have no estate tax, they'll pass the $30 billion to their children. And then that will grow. And so what you would have happening generation after generation is this family, if you say the person who sets up the empire, let's say this is the entire country's GDP, and right when the empire sets up in this person's lifespan, this is their proportion of the GDP, and this is just for simplicity. But if you don't tax it, and this just passively over the course of the next lifespan, if there aren't enough offspring to split up this fortune, as the GDP grows, these people's investments will grow even faster passively. And so over time, this family will grow to own more and more of the nation's wealth without really having to do anything. So it almost creates this kind of nobility class. And obviously, that's what at least many people in the United States view as what's different about America relative to old Europe, to what used to happen in terms of the French Revolution and people just inheriting land generation after generation and never having to work. And this right here is a quote from Winston Churchill on his view of an inheritance tax. He viewed it as a certain corrective against the development of a race of the idle rich. So anyway, that's the explanation of it. You can stand for either side of it, but hopefully this at least gives you the tools to think about whether you're for or against it.